good morning and thank you for attending. About a year ago, I was charged with figuring out Wikipedia, and in a very panicked state, I started blanket emailing all the people I could find on Wikipedia, trying to find someone who could help me understand what I needed to do, and I was very fortunate to come across our next speaker. And then it turned out a month later, I've actually met him at a conference, and I was really excited to put a name with a face. So today's guest is Michael Barrera. He is an archivist at Texas A&M University Commerce. He's a native of Michigan and a graduate of the University of Michigan, from which he received his bachelor's degree in history and his master's degree in archives, records management, preservation of information. He has been a Wikipedian since 2006 and is highly active on the English Wikipedia, where he's created over 60 articles, and on the Wikimedia Commons, where he has contributed over 11,000 photographs. He was the Wikimedian in residence at the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Library in Ann Arbor in 2013, and has presented on this and other Wikipedia-related experiences at The Ohio State University, as well as the University of Michigan. He was also a member of the Michigan Wikipedian Student Club at the University of Michigan before he graduated in 2014. Today, he's presenting us a walk through the Wikiverse, reflections on his 11 years as a Wikipedia. So thank you.
Good morning, how's everyone doing?
Yeah.
First of all, my apologies for making you wait. One of the perks, I guess, of living and working in Commerce, Texas is I have a very regular commute. It's either 7 or 8 minutes every morning. So sorry to be stuck in traffic and a couple accidents on my way in today. But I just wanted to give you a walk through the Wikiverse, some reflections and some ideas, things that I've learned writ large in 11 years, a little more than 11 years now, of being active on Wikipedia and the other Wikimedia. As I noted, I am an archivist at Texas A&M University Commerce, but you know, the real reason I'm here today is the Wikipedia experience. So just a very brief introduction. In one sentence, Wikipedia describes itself as the free encyclopedia that anyone can edit. But to go a little bit deeper, its five pillars, I believe, are the best way to sum up its fundamental principles. Two, it's written from a neutral point of view. Three, it's free content. Four, editors need to treat each other with respect and civility. And five, perhaps most interestingly, it has no firm rules. So these really are the guiding principles behind the project and how it works. So I made my first edit while I was a 15-year-old high school student back in April 2006, kind of fun digging that up again. And Wikipedia editing can be done in one of two ways. One is through the traditional Wiki markup language, which is an HTML derivative. It's a slight simplification of the hypertext markup language. And we've been editing the site since 2006 and before that way. But there's also a WYSIWYG, or what you see is what you get editor, called Visual Editor, that's very nice, much more accessible, much more accommodating for new users, but also something that myself as an experienced user will use quite frequently. It's that convenient. I've actually 33,000 edits to Wikipedia over the past 11 and a half years or so, 15,000 under my present account with my real name, and then the balance with a couple of earlier accounts on which I use pseudonyms. So here's a good page to start with, the UT Arlington page. As it appears live, you've probably seen Wikipedia pages before, the lead, the contents. There's an info box over on the right with basic information spelled out in a brief, easily accessible way. And then here, this is how that same page looks when being edited in the traditional Wiki markup, or the source editing. And you can see this is actually, this complex code is an info box, is the info box. So you can see the curly brackets on the second line indicate the info box. You can see all of the different fields with the names of the fields on the left of the equal sign, and then the value of the field. And you can see certain things, such as double quotation marks indicate italics, triple indicate bold, anywhere you see double square brackets is an internal link, single square brackets are an external link. So you can see it's quite complex. And then contrast that with Visual Editor. This is the WYSIWYG. This is how you can edit the pages now using Visual Edit. And if you contrast that with how the page appears live, it's really not that different. And I think this is really important for Wikipedia's future. It's much easier for somebody who doesn't have HTML experience, who doesn't have a coding background, to edit something that looks like this compared to something that looks like that. So here is actually my very first edit, April 9th, 2006. I was trying to flesh out a disambiguation page, is what it's called on Wikipedia. And at the time, it only disambiguated between two different articles, one on the Soviet tank, one on an American military trainer aircraft. And it's interesting to see, 11 and a half years later, how that article appears. So the two lines, the tank and the aircraft, they're now expanded, there's more context, there are years, there's a manufacturer, but you can see there are lots of other articles that have T-34 in them as well. And one of the cool things about Wikipedia, if you look at the categories at the bottom, it's in a category called letter number combination disambiguation pages. So there are literally scores, if not hundreds, of these pages, just combinations of letters and numbers, and they're all collected together in that category. So you can really see the growth in 11 and a half years. So aside from editing Wikipedia, I've also uploaded photographs to Wikimedia Commons. Commons is the image host behind Wikipedia and the other Wikimedia project sites. I've uploaded over 12,000 of my own photographs now to it. And many of them are used on Wikipedia articles, mostly in English, but also in a variety of other languages. All of my photos are extensively described and categorized, and that really helps users both browse for them and search for them. So, you know, thinking back to my University of Michigan School of Information Education, the difference between browsing and searching, both are used very, very often on Wikimedia Commons. If you're browsing, you go from category to category, and it's important to be able to find images and making them well categorized really helps with that. But also having lots of descriptive text in the description fields as well makes them searchable. I've also geotagged my photos, all of my photos, so that took a while, but it's pretty neat to have over 12,000 geotags and to actually be able to map any or all of my photographs on a map of the world. So here's one example. I'm fairly proud of this picture. This is my only featured picture in Wikimedia Commons. Featured picture is the highest quality of image available on Wikimedia Commons. There is a peer review process. It has to be nominated. It has to be supported. It needs something like 10 support votes within a period of 7 days. It might be 15. It's been a while. But anyway, this is the only one of my 12,000 photographs to be given that honor. It's a neat picture of a pedestrian bridge on the UNC campus in Denton. But you can see this is the media viewer in Wikimedia Commons. It's really a nice way to present the image. You can see my description in the bottom left, my username in the bottom right. There's the license, the Creative Commons Attribution Sharealike 4.0, a link for more details. And then here's the category. So you can see at this point, actually, a little bit over 12,000 photographs. And then here's one in-depth example. This is UTA Santa Fe Freight Depot in Fort Worth. So you can see at the top of the page, you have the image itself. And then you have the summary section. So this is where I put in my description. I'm very careful to date it, to note it as own work, to note my username there under author, and then you can see the exact camera location where it was taken, and the link to OpenStreetMap and Google Earth for generating a map with the geotag coordinates. And then this is the OpenStreetMap version, and you can see at the very center of this image, there's a red and white X, which is the location of my camera when I took this picture of the freight depot. So you can see, and if you look closely, there are these little red, white, and blue Wikimedia Commons logos. They're the kind of almost like rounder looking circle shaped logos. Each one of those is another image. So you can see throughout you know, kind of the southern end of downtown Fort Worth here, you can see all of these other images that were created in these locations. And in the live view, if you hover over with your mouse, it'll actually show the image, which is pretty neat. And then here's my license. I license all of my stuff under Creative Commons Attribution, Share Alike 4.0 International license. But it's not the first license that I started using. So I've actually created this template, which I put on all my pages so I can update my license. And I did this a few years ago because when I started, the 4.0 International didn't exist. So I started dual licensing with these two licenses on the bottom, the 3.0 unported, and then the old GNU Free Documentation license, the GFDL. So when the 4.0 version of the Attribution Share Alike license came out a few years ago, I was able to just modify the template. I made one edit instead of making, you know, 12,000. So that was nice. But it's a nice way to kind of future-proof it. And it's really, really nice to be able to share all of these images under a Creative Commons license like this. So at the end of the day, nobody has to ask me permission to use these images. They just have to do two things. They need to attribute me, and you can see my name is very conspicuously displayed under the attribution. So as long as you cite me, and if you create a derivative of my images, you essentially need to keep it free. You need to publish it under the same or similar license. Other than that, it's totally free. Anybody can do anything they want with it. And it's very gratifying to, you know, to browse the internet sometimes or search the internet sometimes and see where my images are popping up, to see how people are using them. Everything from, you know, local media to blogs to even the Encyclopedia Britannica took one of my images for Ferris State University once and cited it perfectly fine. But that was quite neat to see what happens when you open up resources like this, to see people take them and run. It's really, really neat. And then here are the categories. So you can see there's a whole category just for this building, which is the primary, in my mind, the primary category for this. And then I'm also very careful to, you know, I have this regimen, really. So I put all of my images in month, year categories by location. So this one's June 2016 in Texas. There's a category for photographs taken on that specific day, June 11th, 2016. And then you see all of these hidden categories at the bottom, things like the license, photographs by me taken with a particular type of camera, images with maps. So those are more behind the scenes kinds of categories, but they can be very useful for helping me manage my photographs, or, you know, for somebody who's really interested in finding all the images taken with a particular type of camera or a particular license. And then just very quickly, here is how this whole image page looks when it's opened up with the traditional source editor. So you can see all that information from the description that I showed you at the beginning, at the top, with the little location template at the end of that section with the geocodes. And then you can see how my license appears, that user colon Michael Guerrero / license. And then all the categories at the bottom, actually a whole bunch of those hidden categories are built into my license. You know, the ones about own work, about the three licenses I publish under. So it's not quite as hairy as you might think. Although, you know, still, this can be a little bit overwhelming for somebody who's not used to the code. So now we have a little bit more of a practical example. Here's another image from UNT, the Hurley Administration Building. And then here, if you go to the bottom of the Wikipedia page, it'll tell you where this is used on other wikis. So you can see all of these different sites, four different articles on English Wikipedia, but Arabic, German, Spanish, Persian, Finnish, all of these different language Wikipedias are using this picture to illustrate, in most cases, the article on UNT. So there it is on the English Wikipedia article. There it is on the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex article under this list of colleges and universities in the area, right after UTA. Here it is in German and in Spanish, Japanese, where it's in the gallery. Bottom left, the Chinese Wikipedia, and the Persian Wikipedia. So one of the real advantages of uploading to Wikimedia Commons is that every single language Wikipedia site will read images from Commons as if they were natively uploaded to that Wikipedia. So essentially, you just have to upload it once, and then it can be used anywhere across any Wikipedia, any other Wikimedia project. No local uploads, no hassle at all. The code is exactly the same for each of the languages. So you can see it really was a breeze getting this image onto all of those different sites. To go in a slightly different direction, there's Wikisource, which is very much under the radar, especially compared to Wikipedia. But it's a library, it's a sibling project to Wikimedia, Wikimedia Commons, as well as Wikipedia. It allows users to upload scans of books, magazines, other documents, transcribe them with Wikitext, and then create searchable HTML-like documents that can be easily read online, and then also downloadable EPUB and PDF files of finished transcribed books. So I really enjoy it as a hobby, but it's also a great way for a university library or other libraries to get involved with Wikimedia. So this is a project I'm working on. This is Little Women 2. Sequel to the famous book by Louisa May Alcott. And on the left, you can see the raw OCR, the optical character recognition starting text, essentially. So I just clicked on this page here, the first page of chapter 2. On the right-hand side, you can see the actual deja vu file of the scan of the page. And then as soon as I click edit, the OCR went to work. And it did a pretty good job on this page. You can see it on the left there. Nothing is formatted though. So what I had to do was go through the format. A lot of it is removing line breaks, but also formatting the title text. You can see I'm using a center template and a larger template to adjust the text. So the end result then is this. So on the left is the transcribed text. On the right is the scan itself. And you can see that yellow bar at the top says it's been proofread, but it needs to be validated. So I went through, I proofread, but on Wikisource, all pages need to be validated to be completely finished. And that means a second user has to go through and double check everything. So here's the progress page as it looked a while ago. I've worked on this quite a bit since. But you can see all those yellow pages are the proofread pages. There's one that's been validated in green there. And then there are a few that have problems. Most of them have images on them. Those are in purple. And then everything that's red has not been created yet. So you can see very much a work in progress. And then here's an example of a project that's been completed. This is James Joyce's Portrait of an Artist as a Young Man. And this was actually a group project. Every month, Wikisource has a project of the month, a proofread of the month. And this was something I collaborated on a year or two ago. And you can see everything's green. This one's totally validated. It's totally finished. So here is how the title page appears. And here is how chapter one appears. If you look at on the left, they're very small, but there would appear to be footnotes. There's a number one, the top left, right under the chapter bar at the top. And then the bottom left, there's a number two. If you click on those, then it will take you to the page view. So this is the first page, and you can see the completed text on the left and the scan on the right. And if you notice that it's really quite impressive how much you can do with the code. Things like small caps, centering, alignment, spacing, it's a really powerful language. So this is what the finished product looks like on Wikisource. And then there's also Wikidata, which is new. It's only a couple of years old. It's the central repository for data on Wikimedia sites. It's very much behind the scenes, even more so than Wikisource, but it's really great for coordinating between sites. And as we get more and more into the promise of linked open data, I think it will become very, very powerful. It allows attributes such as birth dates, nationalities, photographs to be assigned unique identifiers corresponding with individual Wikipedia article subjects in a language-neutral way. So it will work between different Wikipedia languages. So here again, here's the UTA example, and you can see all these statements. So it's coding for, you know, it's a university. It's a public educational institution in the U.S. It was created in 1895, located in the U.S. And there are plenty more if you scroll down. But all of these are language neutral, so every language Wikipedia can read these statements. And, you know, if all of these terms can be, so, you know, inception, instance of, all of those statements can be translated into multiple languages. And then on the right, if you look under the Wikipedia section, where it says 12 entries, those are the 12 different language articles that exist right now on UTA. And then images can be included as statements as well. So here's the article on Greenville, the county seat out in Hunt County, where I live. And if you look, the second statement, image, is actually a picture that I took. So it's possible to actually plug in images from Wikimedia Commons into Wikidata, and then that way, when articles are created in other languages, especially smaller Wikipedia projects, it's very easy for them to start with or find an image, an appropriate image on the subject. Then getting into quality a little bit, good articles. Good articles represent a peer review process on Wikipedia and the second highest level of content on the project, behind only featured articles. Both of them have very, very exhausting standards. Featured articles, the big difference is featured articles are supposed to be comprehensive. They're supposed to have really everything important about the topic within them. Good articles don't have that same level, but they do have, you know, things have to be well written, they have to be well formatted, you know, spelling, grammar, all of that, but also very well referenced. The standards are quite high. I have created and approved three articles GA status, a couple on railroad history, and then one on the history, the early history of A&M Commerce when it was East Texas Normal College from 1889 to 1917. And then I have two more articles that are currently waiting for GA review. So I think they're up to snuff, but they need to go through the process. So here's an example. Here's the Bud Michelin rubber-tired rail cars article, which grew out of an article I wrote on the Silver Slipper, which was an old Texas and Pacific train that used to run from Fort Worth to Texarkana. Here's one on GE steam turbine locomotives. Here's the one on the history of East Texas Normal College. So what makes a good article? In large part, it's the references. So this is that history of ETNC article. You can see 39 footnotes and then two core sources. You know, there's certain, you know, the Handbook of Texas Online is used. There are a handful of other books that are used. There's even a peer-reviewed journal article from College English that's used. So in a lot of ways, this actually looks quite a bit like writing an academic paper. And from my experience, writing a high-quality Wikipedia article is a very similar experience to writing an academic paper. Here are the references on the history of East Texas State, which is awaiting GA review, very similar to the previous one. And then probably the most intensive one that I've done so far, 91 footnotes on the Chrysler Turbine Car article. And this had sources. It also has historic newspapers, and I'm sure you recognize that little open orange padlock. So a lot of open access stuff from newspapers.com went into this, in addition to contemporary magazine and newspaper articles. And it's really a good mix of historic and contemporary sources. Also, there's the Did You Know process on the computer, which is a really, really great way to incentivize the creation of new content, as well as improving content by rewarding these articles by running them on the main page for a whole day. The requirements are much less exacting than for good articles, but they still do ensure a fundamental level of quality. And as of this month, I've now nominated and passed successfully 61 DYKs in my career. So to give you an example, you can see these articles are a lot shorter. They're still footnoted, they're still well cited, but they're typically smaller, they're less substantive than the good articles. And I've created these Did You Knows on all these different topics that didn't exist in Wikipedia until I created these articles. Many of them quite obscure, like the Arkansas Air and Military Museum, J. Mace Brewer, who's actually a fairly famous folklorist, who was he finished his career at A&M Commerce, which was still East Texas State University, the Babe Didrikson Zacharias Museum and Visitor Center in Beaumont, the Hopkins County Courthouse in Sulphur Springs. And one of my favorites, the Ezekiel Airship, which some people claimed flew in 1902 in Pittsburgh, Texas. Fascinating story. And here's actually the little blurb at the top shows how the article ran on the main page with the hook and note of running in October 2015 on October 15th. And then on the bottom, you can see the Did You Know section as it appeared on that day. And I was lucky, I submitted a picture that I took with the article. And it was selected to be the lead image and the lead DYK in the section. So that was, it's always a big thrill to get on the main page and to see the number of page views that can result from this process. And that's exactly what DYK is designed to do, is to reward Wikipedia creators for creating content. So then getting into tracking contributions and development, this is really important, especially from an institutional perspective. Not only is this way that I can track my contributions, but it's a way that universities, other institutions that are collaborating with Wikipedia can track their content. Glamorous is fantastic. It's designed to track usage of photographs and other images across all Wikipedia sites. As long as they're in the same category, and you know, I use my photographs by my Guerrera category, I can use photographs contributed by our archive, by our marketing communications department, that I'll talk about in a little bit. I can plug in any of those source categories and get a whole report, which is really, really nice. The page view tool, a page views tool is also great. So it'll let you know the number of views individual articles receive. And there are sub tools like mass views, which allows you to put in a whole subcategory. So for instance, category or subcategory. So I can put in this category on history of A&M commerce. I've written this whole seven article series, and I can put that in, and I can then compare the page views of all seven of those articles. So here's an instance of the Glamorous results. And this is showing my, at the time, almost 12,000 files. You can see most of them are used on English Wikipedia. And then high totals on Wikidata in the third line there, but also Polish Wikipedia, German, French, Spanish, Italian, Russian, Japanese, and Ukrainian, kind of the big ones. And here you can see details, so it's very nice. It shows you the picture, it shows you the title, and then on the right-hand side, it shows you the project and which articles they're used on. So it's really a wonderful way to keep track. And then here is the page views analysis using the UT Arlington article, again, for an example. This is for 20 days in September. You can see how it's fluctuated. 7,200 page views in that 20-day span, averaging almost 350 total a day. And then it's really interesting when you can use this to compare. So this is comparing UTA with UTD, UNT, and A&M Commerce. And you can see UNT is the red line there at the top. Blue is UTA, green is UTD. Unfortunately, they're not color coordinated. A&M Commerce is orange there at the bottom. And then here are the page view results. So you can see in tabular form here, so you can actually just see the numbers in addition to viewing them on the graph. So this is a powerful way to track metrics on articles and compare them to each other. Here is the mass views analysis. And this is for the category History of Colleges and Universities in Texas. So you can actually see, you can look at the seven different articles that I've created on the history of A&M Commerce, and then the four other articles, universities have Wikipedia articles on their history, A&M, UT in Austin, Texas Tech, and Lamar. So I mentioned this a little bit already. I've created a total of 12 Wikipedia articles relating to Texas A&M University Commerce in the last 2.5 years, principally on the history of the university and some of its athletics programs. And then I've also taken photographs of a number of A&M Commerce events and uploaded them to Wikimedia Commons, and then I've often been able to use these photographs in Wikipedia articles, both on the university, but on other subjects too. So So some examples, I started my first year creating some articles on the athletics teams that didn't exist yet. So here's one on the football team, on the women's soccer team, women's volleyball, softball. And then I was a little more audacious last year and did a really, really intensive kind of research project on the history of the university, and wound up creating this kind of umbrella article, kind of a 20,000 foot view on the whole history of the university. And then I dove into each period in its history. So ETNC, when it was a private school until 1917, and then as the names changed over the years, the scope has changed. So as a state normal college, state teachers college, scope broadened and became a state college, then finally a state university, and then 1996 joined the A&F system. So I've created articles on all of those. And then I'm also including J. Mason Brewer because he was a faculty member. And then here are a handful of sets of images that I've taken. So starting in 2015, I've done things like take pictures of the campus, the Cotton Belt Regional Railroad Symposium, a volleyball game, basketball game, softball game, campus again, graduating senior art exhibition, football game, soccer game, cross-country meet, homecoming parade, campus again, track and field meet. You can see all sorts of different opportunities to get out with my camera. In each case, I was taking pictures that I was ultimately sharing freely on Wikimedia Commons, and then using a lot of those pictures in the articles. So one more idea that I really want to leave you with is freely licensing institutional content here. Our marketing communications photography department used to do this when it used to be used Flickr. It's transitioned the last couple years to SmugMug. SmugMug unfortunately doesn't have this capability, but on Flickr you can release your license, your photographs under a Creative Commons license very easily. And they did this, and this allowed me to upload them as a group and use them in Wikipedia articles. So even though when they ported these images to SmugMug, on SmugMug they don't have this license, the Creative Commons licenses are irrevocable. So once they're published, they're out there. So it's still legal for these images that were ported under, while they were on Flickr and freely licensed, still legal for them to be on Wikimedia Commons. And then also my alma mater, the University of Michigan, is currently making a lot of its Bentley Historical Libraries, Bentley Image Bank images, available freely under similar licenses. And I've poked around a little bit, but I haven't really taken advantage of it yet. So when I get some free time, I think I'll dig into that a little bit. But you can see, here's the photographs by the A&M Commerce Marketing Communications Photography Department. So over 3,600 that were released. And you can see here's an example image from an art show. And then here's an interesting case. This is the author, Will Self. And this is actually cropped by a Wikimedian from the original image that was posted by our Marketing Communications Photography Department. And then, as you can probably imagine, very high-quality free image used as his lead image in his info box on his Wikipedia article. And then here's a screenshot of the Bentley Historical Library's Bentley Image Bank. And then this, you know, for somebody like me who's really passionate about freely licensed content and open access, it's very exciting to see these kinds of images come up when you search for freely accessible stuff since 1990. So, you know, I would argue the fifth image there from the left on the top row is what I'm used to seeing when I think of free content. You know, public domain stuff that's really old. But to see color stuff, to see, you know, modern athletics, to see modern portraits, things like that are being released by a major institution like this under a free license is really, really powerful. You can see all the dates on there that are highlighted. And then here's an example of an individual image page on 1991 Michigan-Purdue football game. On the right-hand side of the page, you can see very conspicuously under rights, permissions, and Creative Commons attribution license. So that is one that is compatible with Wikimedia Commons. Anybody can take this image, port it to Wikimedia Commons, and use it in Wikipedia articles. So to learn more, I think the best resources for newcomers on Wikipedia Wikipedia. A couple of them are very new. The Wikipedia Adventures, Learn to Edit Wikipedia in Under an Hour. It's kind of a gamified introduction to the website that's very nice. And then the Tea House bills itself as a friendly place to learn about editing on Wikipedia. It's a very supporting community. Again, a very new initiative, something that Wikipedia has really tried addressing in the last couple of years, is being a more welcoming place for newcomers, which is something we've struggled with for a while. There's also an older tutorial that I've used in the past that's very nice. There's the famous Wikipedia The Missing Manual, which is a user-created guide to using the website, and then kind of the institutional contributing to Wikipedia introduction page as well. It's a nice resource. And then if any of you are interested in learning to edit, getting your feet wet, I would highly encourage you to reach out to me. You know, personal contact is fantastic, especially on a site like Wikipedia that can be a little bit cold and sterile sometimes. And you know, sometimes it's just easier to ask somebody than it is to try to find an answer in a help page. So thank you and happy editing. There's a fine line between improving the content and, you know, blatantly promoting a department. The easiest way to address that, that I found, you know, especially in, you know, kind of a library setting, cultural heritage setting, is to focus more on the content than the institution. So it's easier to, you know, when I was working with the Gerald Ford Presidential Library, we were focusing on the articles on Gerald Ford. We were focusing on articles on Operation Fluid Drive and the Vladivostok Summit on arms control. We weren't focusing on the article on the library or on the museum itself.
So our archivists and librarians could create paper collections within the archives and say that they're housed at UTA Library Special Collections.
On the library itself. Yeah. And I mean, like I said, there's a fine line, and especially with archives, you know, often you have the best resources on this from your institution. You know, so, and I've done some of that, and you know, part of it too is, you know, there's... I am an archivist at A&M Commerce, but I'm also a Wikipedian. You know, and when I'm working in my free time as a Wikipedian, I have a little more latitude to edit on the institution, but I always have to keep in mind, you know, is this, because, you know, I was a Wikipedian before I was an archivist. I'm not going to sabotage the project. I'm not going to bias the project if I can help it. And it's really important to involve other people, you know, going through processes like Did You Know, going through processes like the Good Article Process are really good ways to get other editors substantively involved in articles on institutions.
That was going to be my next question, then I promise I'll shut up. Is there a special sort of extra review process that needs to be in place or that Wikipedia has put in place to review pages that are created by members of institutions to ensure that they're not using the site as a promotional tool?
I mean, there are policies. There's the neutral point of view policy. There's the conflict of interest policy. There's nothing that's too terribly hard. One thing that can be done, though, you know, using edit from IP addresses can be tracked. So anybody who edits without logging in has their IP address tracked to the edit. And then there are actually a whole bunch of Twitter bots that are designed to follow IP addresses. You know, this started with government. So there's these Twitter bots that'll let you know every time somebody using a congressional address edits an article on Wikipedia, it'll tell you. And then the University of Michigan has one now too. So it's possible, it is technically possible to track edits that are made from institutional sites.
But there's no formal review process
outside of, you know, New Page Patrol, you know, all of this stuff that happens.
I also have two questions that are very similar, related to your history pages, history of X, Y, Z institution. Now, I've looked at Wikipedia pages that'll be about an institution, it'll have a history section.
Yeah, uh-huh.
How come you decided to just make a page on the history of the institution instead of the other method? When I say it's sort of related question is, the same thing for categories, those are categories that we're all labeled history of. Is that a controlled vocabulary?
Yeah, so to answer your first question, it's essentially like Russian nesting dolls. So every section can really, on a top level article, like on a university, every section really could have a sub article that splits off. So history can split off into a history of section, split off into an athletics section. You know, athletics can split off into the different sports. So if you think about it, it's really quite hierarchical. And the idea is to have the very important, so on the A&M Commerce article, there's probably, I think, two or three paragraphs on the history. And then the history of A&M Commerce article is, I don't know, 20, 25 paragraphs on the history of the institution. And then that splits off, too, into all of these much more detailed articles. So that's essentially how it works. More developed pages have more of that hierarchy. You know, if you look at the article on the United States of America, every section has a sub-article. You know, there's a section on, for instance, the economy, and then there's a whole other sub-article called Economy of the United States. You know, there's geography, and then there's Geography of the United States as a separate article. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So as you develop, things will develop.
So there's the Texas A&M article probably have a section on history, and that'll have a couple paragraphs, and it'll link.
And it'll link out. It'll say. It'll say main article, you know, see also or see main article, and you click out, and then from that article, you know, you can click out to, you know, history since 1996 or, you know, pre-1917, something like that. Does that make sense? And then the categories work like that too. They're very hierarchical, and this goes kind of into, you know, maybe it's a little bit pedantic, but the distinction between tagging and categorization. Tagging tends to be flat. You have these terms that are universal. You know, everything that's a picture of a dog, you tag it as dog. Whereas with categorization, it's hierarchical. So you would have different dog breeds. You'd have maybe dogs by color. You'd have, you know, historic dog, you know, famous individual dogs under their own separate category. So you have this whole category that's, you know, history of universities and colleges in Texas. And that's a subcategory of both history of universities and colleges in the United States, and then also universities and colleges in Texas. And you know, you can climb up, you know, you can get to Texas, you can get to universities and colleges, you can get to history. It's very hierarchical, so the idea is that each category is very precise in the pages that it contains. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so is that a controlled vocabulary?
It's not a truly controlled vocabulary. It's not like using the Library of Congress subject headings or anything like that. It is created essentially on the fly by Wikimedians, but there's a strong preference towards standardization. So at some point, often early on, the exact verbiage was decided, and then you're going to have, you know, histories of universities and colleges in California. Like the structure of those category names is going to be, in theory, it's going to be the same between different states, between different countries. And, you know, Wikipedia is a work in progress. There are always exceptions to the rules. Nothing is perfect. But especially as time goes on, things get more and more standardized. They get more categorized. They get cleaned up. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
As those pages get get categorized, or as you create new ones, are you the one, is the editor the one categorizing, or is it, you know, peers that are reviewing that stuff?
Typically, the creator will start the page by putting, you know, creating categories for it at the beginning, but then other editors can categorize too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a mix of both. One thing that's really amazing about Wikipedia is the amount of specialization that people do. You know, I tend to be a content creator, I create articles, I upload images. There's some people that who are really administrators, some people are really good at doing things like fighting vandalism. Some editors, almost all they do is fight vandalism. Some people are very good with categorization. And I'm actually quite strong with categorization, especially on comments. But you know, there's some people who are on Wikipedia and they're doing that, they're going from article to article, working on you know, reducing redundancy, improving categorization, things like that. So it's kind of a mix, and you never know. Sometimes there'll be an anonymous an IP editor. Sometimes, you know, it'll just be serendipity. Somebody will stumble across it and make an improvement.
Yeah, you mentioned good articles versus featured articles.
Yes.
I had some question on my mind.
Uh-huh.
So for example, as a user of Wikipedia,
mm-hmm.
How can I tell whether it's a good article, a featured article, or any other article? And also as a user, does that matter for me to know whether it's featured or good?
Yes.
From a user's point of view.
Yes. So good articles, in the very top right corner, there's this little green plus on a little green circle. That's the symbol for a good article, and I don't have an example. Well, you know what? I can use the live for that, right?
Okay.
And then a featured article will have a little bronze star. So there is, top right, this little bronze star. That is a featured article. And then, like I said, a good article will have a little green plus. And if you hover over it, it'll tell you it's a good article. If you click on it, it'll give you more information. And if I go back to the featured article, same thing there. Featured articles really are the best quality articles on Wikipedia. I tend to think of featured articles as being like a gold medal, and the good articles as being a silver medal. It's comparable, but it's not as good. And you will notice, you know, because the quality varies from article to article, but if you look at a featured article, this is even more impressive than a good article. Very detailed, a lot of images. If you look at all of those footnotes, really well done. And I always like counting the footnotes. 78 footnotes, 3 books. You know, that's quite impressive. That's, and like I said, when you read it, you can really tell the difference. I mean, the quality of Wikipedia articles across the board has really been increasing in the past 5 or 10 years, but featured articles, they're very, very good. Good articles aren't quite to the same standard, but you'll notice it when you're reading them, especially the featured articles. And like I said, look for that bronze star, look for that little green plus. That'll tip you off. Does that make sense?
Yeah. If I don't see anything like that, then that's just a...
Yes. So if you don't see anything, actually Bart Simpson's a featured article too. Anagram. There's one, and it doesn't have anything. Now, if you're really interested, you could go to the talk page. And the talk page has the assessment class. So start is the second lowest. If I go to Wikiproject literature here, then you have this bar here. So stub is the lowest, then start is one level above, then C, then B, then good article. A is a transitory phase. It's essentially for articles that are being prepped for a featured article status. And then featured article is the top. So that gives you a little, and that's very behind the scenes. But if you, and every Wikipedia article has a talk page. And at the top of the talk page, it should have information about class and review. Yeah, so you can see the featured article tags here. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
You showed the pages about like the analytics of the pages that you edited.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a spot where you could see analytics for like all of Wikipedia or something? Like, maybe, like who's, how many people are visiting, what pages are the most visited?
Oh yeah, oh absolutely. Yes, let me go to... So here's page views. This is on this single article. But if you go to this, you have all these different views here. So you have top views. Top view shows the current, let's see, oh, this is September. Yeah, so here, these are the top 10 most viewed Wikipedia articles, English Wikipedia, in the month of September. So you see, it tends to be pretty topical. You can see it, Hurricane Irma, but you know, some, you know, Darth Vader's on there. Bookmark is on there. So it's interesting to look. But this is that page views tool I was talking about. Mass views I mentioned, page views I mentioned, and then the top views sub tool is very useful. For you can put in a project, so you could put in, for instance, you could check and see what Spanish Wikipedia looked like. And you see the 1985 earthquake is the top article, but it again is number two in Spanish. So you can see on any project, it looks like the data from October is not in yet. But you can look at, actually you could probably look at weekly or daily. So we could look at English Wikipedia and see what were the top viewed articles yesterday. So does that make sense?
Yeah, and my follow-up question, or like why I might be concerned about that is, Wikipedia is like striving for neutrality, but how would you maintain that? Like, who is editing them? And if there's like an imbalance in like maybe education, demographics,
mm-hmm.
something
yeah.
like that, like will that depend on or affect like which books get transcribed, which historical figures get pages about them?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's one thing that kind of comes with the territory on Wikipedia when you have an encyclopedia created by volunteers, is that you don't tell them what to edit. Everybody kind of gravitates towards their own interests, which is an empowering thing. But Wikipedia does have demographic problems. It's overwhelmingly male, it's overwhelmingly white, it's overwhelmingly college educated, it's overwhelmingly, you know, upper middle class to affluent. It's overwhelmingly global north compared to global south. So there are a whole bunch of initiatives targeting the Global South, the whole Women in Red editathons trying to address the gender gap. There are lots of really good initiatives that have been rolled out in the last few years, many of them getting a lot of support, but still, at the end of the day, you know, almost 80%, maybe over, almost 90%, I think it's 88% of Wikipedia is male. So you have a really big gender imbalance, and that does, to some extent, that affects content. I think there are some checks on it, because, you know, one of the things we say on Wikipedia is we're collectors. So, you know, we're not, when we create content, we're always citing it to other materials. So, you know, we're always, I don't think that we're introducing as much bias as sometimes we're claimed to when we're creating articles, but there are still certainly problems, even things as basic as what articles are getting created, what articles aren't. Some of my interests, you know, history of education, transportation history, athletics, things like that. Some of those areas are quite well represented. And then there are other areas, like African history, for instance, is not well represented on Wikipedia. It's getting better, but you know, if you look at something like history of video games or history of the internet or something like that, those areas are much better covered, and you can see there is a real connection between the demographics on the site and between what is really well covered versus what is not.
Can you talk about the roles of AI on Wikipedia? Are they purely for correcting policing, like catching profanity, or they're having a role in creating content?
So on Wikipedia, there are, you know, we refer to them as bots. And they're essentially just computer scripts that run autonomously or semi-autonomously. And let me see if I can get you a list of requests for approval. So if you look at requests for approval, you get a sense for what exactly they do. Some of them, all they do is they correct certain typos. So, you know, there's certain very common typographical errors that they can be coded to clean up. Some of them fight vandalism. A lot of them do, like splitting pages, merging pages, or for instance, if a category is renamed and there are a whole bunch of pages in that category, you can assign that to a bot. It's much more efficient. So some of them add wiki project banners on the talk pages. Some of them are removing commas. A lot of them work with info boxes. You know, those coding, sometimes info boxes become deprecated, they get merged. Anything that's very repetitive tends to be the kind of task that's assigned to bots. You know, very much like, you know, factory work that's assigned to robots. They're really not terribly intelligent. You know, they're scripts that are programmed to, you know, to look for certain conditions and to edit them, to make edits in line with those. They're very, very useful, but it's not like they're making big or hard decisions. They're typically very closely guided by human users, at least at this point. And I'm sure as technology advances, as AI advances, we may see more autonomous, more capable bots in the future, but they certainly fill a very useful role at this point. Go ahead.
Oh, I thought it was something.
Yeah.
Can you speak to the difference between campaigns and wiki projects and how collecting institutions can maybe use those?
Yeah, so wiki projects are very topic-based. So a wiki project is organized around a topic, an idea, a set of articles. It's not at all about an institution. Campaigns tend to be more institution-based or sometimes more, you know, goal-based, greater goal-based. Some of them are designed to work on content, you know, related to underrepresented minorities or women or Global South, things like that. Campaigns really have more of like an initiative kind of feel to it, whereas wiki projects are much more a group of editors with a common interest working on a common set of articles together, coming from a variety of different backgrounds. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and can you do you have any advice on finding projects that might wiki projects that might be of topical interest, you know, if you are representing an institution?
Yeah. I mean, there's a whole...
I've looked and it seems really overwhelming, so...
Yeah. There's a whole Wiki Project Council. I mean, there are a tremendous amount of Wiki projects. One thing I will say, though, is that Wiki projects very often... most of them become inactive, or mostly inactive. I think only the really big ones, you know, things like Military History, which is the one that everybody points to as a shining success story. Wiki Project Medicine is also another very good one. Only the really big ones tend to stay around and keep producing year after year after year. Smaller projects, you know, they tend to have like 3-4 people. People leave, they kind of fizzle out. So a lot of the work these days kind of happens outside of wiki projects. It's more a case of editors, you know, communicating directly with each other via user talk pages, communicating about topics on the article's talk page. So a lot of that work isn't happening in wiki projects anymore. So I think we may be getting into a world now where campaigns are more valuable. Things like edit-a-thons, the women in red edit-a-thons, the art and feminism edit-a-thons, things like that. Those may be the way of the future, getting people together, working in those moments. And then more of the work, like I said, is going to be individual project, individual article, person-to-person, kind of one-to-one coordination, I think, going forward. But there is the wiki project directory here, and you can search, you can see all these different wiki projects. Better than, odds are though that most of these projects, even the ones listed here, are probably inactive or semi-active. So, you know, even if you find something, you might be disappointed if there's, you know, no action or very little action there. So I would recommend going into the articles, going into the topics, and don't be shy about posting on the talk pages, about posting on user talk pages of users who've edited in the past or who are actively editing. I think that's the way we're going on Wikipedia.
So going to the transcription that you've been doing.
Mm-hmm. On Wikisource?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So you did say it was being OCR, and I know that Wiki has been doing some work around accessibility for disabilities,
mm-hmm.
but how are they applying that to like individual editors? So guidelines they push out to crowdsourcing?
No. That is something that really happens more at the kind of the institutional level, the Wikimedia Foundation level. I believe that the website, and I mean the only real thing you have to be aware of with as an editor, and something that's required on featured articles, is putting in alternate text on images. Other than that, everything should be handled by the back end, just the way that the site, and not the wiki markup text, but the way the actual site has been coded by the developers. Everything should be very friendly for screen readers. It's very easy to change the size on a Wikipedia article. There's a skin, this is the vector skin, the default, and I think there's a special skin that's high contrast, that's easier to read too. That's not something that most editors are really down in the weeds with. That's something that's really taken care of by the foundation and their legal team. But to the best of my knowledge, the site is quite accessible.
And so when you were adding the transcription,
mm-hmm.
the OCR was handled on through which when you uploaded it's converting?
So if I go, I go to my contributions. So here is that Little Women 2 project. So when I click on new page, to create a page, and you see it just loaded like that. So it OCRs automatically on loading. And you see it's quite good. You know, sometimes it has a few typos. You know, sometimes it reads something like an LI is an H or something like that. But overall, the OCR is quite good. And in my time using it, it's gotten better. So I can tell they've been improving it. But something like this, is a project that's in the works. For an end user, this really isn't useful. This is not ready yet. This is still a work in progress. It's not until you complete the whole project. So if you look here, there's the source. So this is the source page, right? So this is what we were looking at with Little Women 2. When a project is finished, you'll link to it here. So you'll create this actual content page. And then this is how it's read. So for something like Little Women 2, it doesn't exist yet. Confusingly, this links to Little Women, the original book. But when this is finished, this will be cleaned up. This will link to a separate page of finished content on this book. So right now, we don't have to worry about accessibility on this. Obviously, obviously when we're done, everything will be, you know, it will be publicly available. It will be readable by a screen reader. You know, obviously the deja vu image files are inaccessible at this point, but that's part of why we're doing this. That's why we're transcribing, is to make it accessible. You're welcome. Anyone else?
For your work at the Gerald R. Ford as the Wikimedian in residence, can you talk a little bit about what that job actually entails and if it was just you flying solo or how you can work with students on using Wikipedia as a teachable thing?
Yeah, so that was a 4-hour-a-week internship for one semester, so like 13, 14 weeks. Not as much as I would have liked to have done, but I was able to create a whole article from scratch with their resources. So a DYK level article, never got to GA, but on the Vladivostok summit on nuclear arms limitation between the United States and the Soviet Union, Ford and Brezhnev. So I did that, did a whole bunch of wrangling with uploads. So there was another editor who was involved in the Wiki project on Gerald Ford that existed at the same time, who did a batch upload for us. He specialized in that. And I was going through, I was standardizing templates, I was standardizing categories, I was doing a lot of that. I was placing images sensibly that were being uploaded into Wikipedia articles, you know, with that rule of thumb in mind about making sure a third-party editor would say, hey, that actually improved the project. Again, that's a fine line, but that's something that's really important to keep in mind. So it was really those three things, cleaning up images, adding images, and then that one main article for article creation. And then, I take that back, we also had an edit-a-thon at the end of the project. So we planned an edit-a-thon. We had a whole bunch of stakeholders, you know, students, faculty, community members, from the university and from the surrounding community come in for that edit-a-thon, which went really well. But again, it was, you know, it was only, you know, four hours a week for one academic term. So it didn't do a ton, but, you know, enough to create a lasting impact, and really help try to further that relationship between academia and the university and Wikipedia.
Can you speak more about the relationship between Wikipedia and the Wikipedia Foundation? So I understand Wikipedia is supposedly purely volunteerism, but mm-hmm. then to what extent Wikipedia Foundation being the supporter or developer in some sense of the infrastructure?
Mm-hmm.
And so do you, like, for example, what you see is what you get when they implemented it,
mm-hmm.
how much say did the editors of Wikipedia have in the involvement of it? Or was the what you see is what you get was developed, was that open access as well?
Mm-hmm.
So
no, that's a good question. So the Wikimedia Foundation is the not-for-profit behind the Wikipedia and all the other Wikimedia sites. Traditionally, it takes care of development of technology and servers, essentially. So it started out as very technical. It's grown a lot in terms of both, funding and expenses, and also employees in the last few years. It's really expanded beyond just providing server space and just providing basic tools to doing things like outreach, to doing, you know, Wikipedia in the classroom. There's a whole project that's spun off on Wikipedia in education. It's the one that's really pushing initiatives on engaging female editors, engaging the Global South, and it's really created a lot of really innovative tools in the last 5 years. Visual Editor is one of them. That's a really good example because there was some pushback in the community. That was a project that was very, very highly lauded. A lot of people will tell you, especially veteran editors, will tell you that it wasn't ready when it was rolled out. There was pushback from a lot of the veteran editors. Although, to be fair, you know, if you think about the demographics of, you know, the core editing community of which I'm a part, we can sometimes tend to be kind of conservative with the new things that are coming out of the foundation. You know, so to take a step back, I think it's good for the movement. I think it's good for editors. I think it's good for recruiting new editors. But sometimes, you know, there's sometimes, you know, almost an inherent conservatism in kind of the old guard. People have always done it this way. you know, I've been editing Wikipedia for 10 years, this needs to be here, this needs to be here, because that's the way that it's always been. So I think it's really good that there's so much new stuff coming out of the foundation. A lot of new technologies, you know, the visual editor. There was a really, really nice upload wizard that was created on Wikimedia Commons 5 or 6 years ago that was a big improvement over the old way to do things. But like I said, you know, you kind of have this really dedicated, very, very committed group of editors like myself. You know, so it's kind of a balancing act sometimes for the foundation between keeping the core editors happy, you know, the people who really do the lion's share of the work on the project, and then also making sure that we're appealing to people who aren't editors yet, you know, because sometimes just with the demographics, with the history, with our experience, you know, Wikipedia editors can almost be a little bit cliquish. You know, we're very familiar with this terminology, we're very familiar with this technology, but other people who haven't been doing this for 10, 15 years, it can be overwhelming to them. And that's really important to keep in mind as someone who's editing so long. Does that make sense?
As those pages get categorized, or as you create new ones, are you the one, is the editor the one categorizing, or is it, you know, peers that are reviewing that stuff?
Typically, the creator will start the page by putting, you know, creating categories for it at the beginning, but then other editors can categorize too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a mix of both. One thing that's really amazing about Wikipedia is the amount of specialization that people do. You know, I tend to be a content creator, I create articles, I upload images. There's some people that are really administrators, some people are really good at doing things like fighting vandalism. Some editors, almost all they do is fight vandalism. Some people are very good with categorization. And I'm actually quite strong with categorization, especially on comments. But you know, there's some people who are on Wikipedia and they're doing that, they're going from article to article, working on you know, reducing redundancy, improving categorization, things like that. So it's kind of a mix, and you never know. Sometimes there'll be an anonymous, an IP editor. Sometimes, you know, it'll just be serendipity. Somebody will stumble across it and make an improvement.
Yeah, you mentioned good articles versus the featured articles.
Yes.
I have some question on my mind.
Uh-huh.
So for example, as a user of Wikipedia,
mm-hmm.
How can I tell whether it's a good article, a featured article, or any other article? And also as a user, does that matter for me to know whether it's a featured or good?
Yes.
From a user's point of view.
Yes. So good articles, in the very top right corner, there's this little green plus on a little green circle. That's the symbol for a good article, and I don't have an example. I can use the lighter for that, right?
Yeah.
And then a featured article will have a little bronze star. So there is, top right, this little bronze star. That is a featured article, and then like I said, a good article will have a little green plus. And if you hover over it, it'll tell you it's a good article. If you click on it, it'll give you more information. If I go back to the featured article, same thing there. Featured articles really are the best quality articles on Wikipedia. I tend to think of featured articles as being like gold medal, and the good articles as being a silver medal. It's comparable, but it's not as good. And you will notice, you know, because the quality varies from article to article, but if you look at a featured article, this is even more impressive than a good article. Very detailed, a lot of images. If you look at all of those footnotes, really well done. I always like counting the footnotes. 78 footnotes, 3 books. You know, that's quite impressive. That's, and like I said, when you read it, you can really tell the difference. I mean, the quality of Wikipedia articles across the board has really been increasing in the past 5 or 10 years, but featured articles, they're very, very good. Good articles aren't quite to the same standard, but you'll notice it when you're reading them, especially the featured articles. And like I said, look for that bronze star, look for that little green plus. That'll take you off. Does that make sense?
Yeah. If I don't see anything like that, then that's just a
yes.
So
if you don't see anything, actually Bart Simpson's picture. Anagram there. There's one and it doesn't have anything. Now if you're really interested, you could go to the talk page. And the talk page has the assessment class. So start is the second lowest. I go to literature here, then you have this bar here. So stub is the lowest, and start is one level above, then C, then B, then good article. A is a transitory phase. It's essentially for articles that are being prepped for a featured article status, and then featured article is the top. So that gives you a little, and that's very behind the scenes. But if you, and every Wikipedia article has a talk page. And at the top of the talk page, it should have information about class and review. Yeah, so you can see the feature article tags. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
You showed the pages about like the analytics of the pages that you edited.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a spot where you could see analytics for like all of Wikipedia or something, like maybe like who's, how many people are visiting what pages are the most visited?
Oh yeah, oh absolutely. Yes, let me go to, okay. So here's page views. This is on this single article, but if you go to this, you have all these different views here. So you have top views. Top view shows the current, let's see, this is September. Yeah, so here, these are the top 10 most viewed Wikipedia articles, English Wikipedia, in the month of September. So you see, it tends to be pretty topical. You can see it, Hurricane Irma. But, you know, some, you know, Darth Vader's on there. Bookmark is on there. So it's interesting to look. But this is that page views tool I was talking about. Max views I mentioned, page views I mentioned, and then the top views sub tool is very useful for, you can put in a project. So you can put in, for instance, you could check and see what Spanish Wikipedia looked like. Oh, you see the 1985 earthquake is the top article, but it again is number two in Spanish. So you can see it. You can see on any project, it looks like the data from October is not in yet. But you can look at actually probably weekly or daily. So we could look at English Wikipedia and see what were the top viewed articles yesterday. So does that make sense?
Yeah, and my follow-up question, or like why I might be concerned about that, is Wikipedia is like striving for neutrality, but how would you maintain that? Like who is editing them, and if there's like an imbalance in like maybe education, demographics, something
yeah.
like that. Like, will that depend on or affect like which books get transcribed, which historical figures get pages about them?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's one thing that kind of comes with the territory on Wikipedia when you have an encyclopedia created by volunteers, is that you don't tell them what to edit. Everybody kind of gravitates towards their own interests, which is an empowering thing. But Wikipedia does have demographic problems. It's overwhelmingly male, it's overwhelmingly white, it's overwhelmingly college educated, it's overwhelmingly, you know, upper middle class to affluent. It's overwhelmingly global north compared to global south. So there are a whole bunch of initiatives targeting the global south, the whole women in red, trying to address the gender gap. There are lots of really good initiatives that have been rolled out the last few years, many of them getting a lot of support, but still, at the end of the day, you know, almost 80%, maybe almost 90%, I think it's 88% of so you have a really big gender imbalance. And that does, to some extent, that affects content. I think there are some checks on it, because one of the things we say on Wikipedia is work with collectors. So, we're not, when we create content, we're always citing it to other materials. So, we're always, I don't think that we're introducing as much bias as sometimes we're claiming to when we're creating articles, but there are still certainly problems, even things as basic as what articles are getting created, what articles aren't. Some of my interests, history is education, transportation history, athletics, things like that. Some of those areas are quite well represented, and then there are other areas, like African history, for instance, is not well represented on Wikipedia. It's getting better, but if you look at something like history of video games, or history of the internet, or something like that, those areas are much better covered, and you can see there is a real connection between the demographics on the site, and between what is really well covered versus what is not.
Can you talk about the roles of AI on Wikipedia? Are they purely for correcting, policing, like catching profanity, or
mm-hmm.
they're having a role in creating content?
So on Wikipedia, there are, we refer to them as bots. And they're essentially just computer scripts that run autonomously or semi-autonomously. And let me see if I can get you a list of to change the size on a Wikipedia article. There's a skin. This is the vector skin, the default. I think there's a special skin that's high contrast. It's easier to read too. That's not something that most editors are really down in the weeds with. That's something that's of by the foundation and their legal team. But to the best of my knowledge, the site is quite accessible.
And so when you were adding the transcription,
mm-hmm.
the OCR was handled on through which when you uploaded it's converted?
So if I go to my contributions. So here is that Little Women's Hue project. So when I click on new page, to create a page, and you see it just loaded like that. So it OCRs automatically on loading. And you see it's quite good. Sometimes it has a few typos. Sometimes it reads something like an L-I is an H or something like that. But overall, the OCR is quite good. In my time using it, it's gotten better, so I can tell they've been improving it. But something like this, this is a project that's in the works. For an end user, this really isn't useful. This is not ready yet. This is still a work in progress. It's not until you complete the whole project. So if you look here, there's the source. So this is the source page, right? So this is what we were looking at with Little Women too. When a project is finished, you'll link to it here. So you'll create this actual content page. And then this is how it's read. So for something like Little Women 2, don't think. Yeah, it doesn't exist yet. Confusingly, this links to Little Women, the original book. But when this is finished, this will be cleaned up. This will link to a separate page of finished content on this book. So right now, we don't have to worry about accessibility on this. Obviously, when we're done, everything will be, it will be publicly available. It will be readable by a screen reader. Obviously the deja vu image files, are inaccessible at this point. But that's part of